So carrying on with the proof of cellular approximation theorem, we have proved it for the case when both domain and codomain have just one cell. So I will recall that lemma and then immediately extend it to one step ahead. So let us see, what was the lemma? The lemma was that you have a map from Dn Sn minus 1, which is like a, you know, relative CW complex with one cell, right? To YB, which is also a relative CW complex with one cell. Dimension of this M is bigger than N. That is the crucial thing. Then this any map like this can be homotoped to a map which is completely, now the last patch of X1 is inside B. Okay, it can be pushed inside B. So this is the lemma. Now we want to do the same thing with YB a little generalized. The domain we keep the same. So this is the first corollary here. Let YB be any CW complex. That means it's a relative CW complex. Then for every map alpha, Dn Sn minus 1 to Y, Yn minus 1 skeleton I'm taking here. Okay? You see, Dn Sn minus 1, Y, there is a homotopy H from Dn cross I to Y such that H of x0 is alpha x to begin with. H of xt will be alpha x always on the boundary. And H of x1 will be in the nth skeleton, yn. Y is any CW complex. If it's already lower dimension than n, there is nothing to prove. So the point is, I am implicitly assuming that there are cells of higher dimension. Okay. And moreover, if already alpha is going inside yn, there is nothing to prove. Okay. So it is implicitly, I have to take the case wherein the original map alpha is mapped onto some higher dimension cells here. Maybe lower also, part of it is higher dimension, so on. But this time, there may be several cells here. Okay, so how to handle this case? The very first thing to notice is that alpha of Dn being compact set, it will meet only finitely many open cells of Y. So this is what we have seen, every compact subset with the union of only finitely many open cells. Okay. Amongst all these cells, because finitely many, there will be some largest dimension one. And that largest dimension is less than or equal to n, there is nothing to prove. So that largest dimension m, let us say, assume that is bigger than n. And let us take one of those cells. There may be finitely many of them, maybe 5,000 or whatever, but take one of them, fix one of them. Okay. So let EM denote one of the cells of highest dimension. That means what? I have assumed that alpha of Dn intersects this EM in the interior of EM. Otherwise, I am not interested in that. Okay. Now what I do, I will look at this just local EM and the rest of EM is attached to something, okay, and the rest of the lower dimensional Y. I am not interested in the higher dimensional skeleton of Y. So I am looking at the mth skeleton of Y, YM, Y top M, amongst that, I am just looking at just one cell. All the other cells are disjoint from it. Okay, right now I am concentrating on this M cell. Okay. So look at this situation. Okay, replace the old B in the lemma by YM minus 1 and Y by just B union this EM. Just look at that. So that is the picture that we have. Then the lemma gives a homotopy of alpha to a map alpha 1 relative to SN minus 1 so that alpha of DM can be pushed into not exactly YM minus 1. This what I'm taking is there are other cells, okay? One of them, one at a time. Okay. So that's why I am calling it a YM minus. In finitely many steps, you will actually get rid of all the top dimensional things. Now you have been inside YM minus 1. Now again do the same thing for if M minus 1 is bigger than M, do the same thing for these cells. There will be finitely many. So in finitely many steps repeated, what you will get is finally the map will be inside YN. Okay. So that is a corollary. Map will be inside YN, it's homotopic too. Each time the homotopy is constant on the boundary of SN minus 1. Okay. So one after another, you keep homotoping so and pushing it lower and lower till you hit only YN, the nth skeleton. Okay. So DN was dimension N. Finally, the homotopy is inside the YN. So that is a cellular map. Okay. So the cellular approximation theorem, when the domain has only one cell, is completed. Okay. Now you can do it for finitely many, etc. That is not a big trick, but we have to do it for the entire thing finally, infinite case also. The infinite case in the domain is not so easy to get rid of. Whereas in the codomain, we got it very easily. It will never come. Each time you have a compact thing, so the image will be contained in a finitely many things. So we are working in a finite case. Okay. So domain you have to be more careful, but for this also we have a ready-made thing when we proved local contractibility of CW complexes, we showed how to compose infinitely many homotopies. Okay, so that we are going to use now. In between we have to use one more technical result also. Okay, now let us complete the proof of the theorem. Inductively, we shall construct a family HN from X cross I to YB such that the starting point H0, H1, H2 and so on, H0 of X0 is Fx, okay? HN of XT is always Fx for X in X prime. Remember, X prime was what? A subcomplex on which F is already cellular. So we don't want to disturb this one. So this I may not say again and again, but this is to be assumed all the time. We are not going to disturb this part at all. We are going to change the map by homotopy only on cells which are not in X prime. Okay. So at the H naught, how we are going to do, etc. You see. Next thing is Hn of x0 will be Hn minus 1 of x1. Okay, this is what is going to help us by looking at like path compositions. So this composition is not it's concatenation. It is not a composition of maps. It's like a composition of paths. So starting point of Hn at 0 is the end point of Hn minus 1. So this is needed for composition. Okay, let us have this also, namely, this is needed for passing to infinity, namely, Hn of xt is always Hn minus 1 of xt for all x in xn minus 1, actually a chain of x1 is constant map. It is just some the map like f1, f2, f3, and so on. I don't want to have another notation here. The deformed thing of original f. So that will not be disturbed on hn minus 1 when constructing hn. That is the meaning of this one. So these hns are extensions of, you know, natural extensions of hn minus 1. Okay. Finally, the endpoint of hn is a cellular on xn. Okay, which means the ith skeleton will go inside ith skeleton only for points of xn. Beyond that, we have not yet done. Okay, so this is the inductive step we want to construct. Having constructed h0, you must be able to construct h1, then h2, and so on. This is just a proposition. We have to do this one. We have to construct this. Okay, all right. Once we have done that, let us see why we have done all this. Once you have done that, it is immediate consequence of the old thing, namely composing various HNs in one single shot, namely H of XT we are going to take like this. Remember, this is what we did, but in there I did it towards zero. Instead, now I am doing it towards one. That is the only difference. Deliberately, I have done it so that you will know both of them. So between n minus 1 by n and n divided by n plus 1, okay, you use hn minus 1 appropriately parameterized. So you are composing hn minus 1, then hn minus hn, and so on. Okay. Finally, hn, if it is not in this for every t between 0 and open one, it will lie here. Okay, but t equal to 1 itself is not here. For t equal to 1, what do you do? Take hn of xt equal to hn of x, h of xt equal to hn of xt, which is already defined. What is this hn? That will depend upon where x is. X is inside n. Okay, x is some inside n. So you could take. So this is what is going to help us, because suppose x is already in xn minus 1, then this will coincide with hn of hn minus 1 of x0 or x4t or whatever earlier map. So this map, this is well defined. Okay, or suppose we are already hn minus 2 and so on, your choice of n is not quite unique here, but the definition doesn't depend upon that. So that is the consequence of this, the third hypothesis here. Okay, the second hypothesis allows us to define like this. You know, take a T, there is a unique N. Use that N to define this one. When you have the n minus 1 by n will coincide with the previous one. So the two definitions will coincide. Hn minus 1 of x0 will be equal to hn minus 2 of x1 and so on. So they will coincide. There is no problem. That is because of 2 here. And all the time, hn of xt, if x is inside x prime, it's always fx. Okay? So each of them have that property. So this property will be here also. Okay. So we have to do this job. The 1, 2, 3, 4 we have to do. So this we will do one by one. So first we have to do H0. So how do we do the H0? Okay. Anything we said inside X prime, I am not going to touch. Therefore, take a vertex, the zero cell, which is not in x minus 1. This x minus 1 is just x prime. In the, remember, x prime, if you take, you think of x prime as the relative part here. So x minus 1 you can write. for that. Okay, then you have attached zero cell, attached one cell, and so on. You choose a path omega x from fx to some point in y naught. The entire y CW complex, okay, has to be built up on the zero cells. Okay, or the relative part. In y naught, we are including the relative part also. Therefore, every point has to be joined to one of the points of y naught. Okay, this is an elementary result for CW complexes. The number of connected components of any CW complex, okay, in each of them, there will be always one zero cell or a part of the relative part. Relative cell has to be there in each of the connector components, path connector components. So you can join this fx to y naught. That path itself is a homotopy for each point. Put them all together because this x naught minus x1 is a discrete set. So just put them together, it will be homotopy. So h naught, little h naught of xt, I have defined fx for x in x prime, no disturbance, for all x which is not in x prime, so x naught is omega f. This path. So this is a homotopy, this is a continuous function. Okay? And what is it, the last value, t equal to 1? T equal to 1, this will be a point of y naught. So it is cellular map. X naught goes to y naught. Rest of x prime all is already inside y prime, whatever. It's cellular there. I don't care about that. Since now comes the point. This is only defined on x naught, right? It's x naught cross I. But I want this HIs, capital HIs here, all of them, defined on the whole of x cross I. So how do I do that? Here I use the property that every subcomplex of a CW complex is, the inclusion map is a cofibration. It has a homotopy extension property. Okay, just for your benefit, I will recall it from part one. A homotopy extension property was this kind of a diagram. Start with A contained inside X. These are subspaces. A is a subspace of some space. The inclusion map is there, eta. This is called a cofibration if whenever you have a map like this one, G from X to Y, and restricted to A, there is a homotopy of that, A cross I to Y. This diagram is coming to its means. G I have taken, then I am restricting G to this part A. That part, the restricted part is homotopic. There is a homotopy itself. Take the homotopy itself, Y. So this is data. A cross I is eta cross identity. X cross 0 is also inclusion. X cross 0 goes to X cross 0. Okay. This part, there is nothing for all. Suppose this much is given. Then there is a map capital H here, which makes this entire diagram commutative. That means restricted to X cross 0, this capital H with a homotopy is the homotopy of this G. Okay? And on the restriction on the subspace, there is a homotopy. That homotopy, this homotopy capital H extends this F. The restriction, this restriction is F. That means H is an extension of that. So this is called homotopy extension. This is homotopy on a subspace, it's an extension of this homotopy of the extended map here. This map itself is defined on all of G. Okay. So that is called homotopy extension property. If A is a subcomplex of X, this will be always true. This is what we have proved. Okay, we have proved it just 2 days back here by using another tool that we had done in part one, namely, what was that picture? This picture, X cross I deforms to, retracts to X cross 0 union A cross I, if A to X is a cofibration. Okay, using this trick, we had proved that. So I am going to use that property, started with I have constructed H, little h naught on X naught cross I. Now I extend it to the whole of X cross I. Okay. I mean, I extend means there is an extension. That is a theorem. I'm using that. So I get a, this little h naught gets extended to capital H naught having all these properties. This property one here, there is nothing more than that. Now you assume that you have done with Hn minus 1. So Hn minus 1, you extend it to Hn exactly same way. How do you do that? First, you will get little Hn by our corollary. How do you do that? One by one, you get the extensions. Okay, so the whole of nth skeleton, you can define that map. We can patch it up because on the n minus one skeleton, wherever you are attaching, they agree. Therefore, you get a whole map from X n cross I to Y. Okay, so I will repeat that part. Inductively, suppose we have defined Hn minus 1 with the property as specified. Specified means 1, 2, 3, 4. For each n cell Enj, okay, in Xn, or Eni or Enj, Xn minus X prime. X prime you don't touch. So it's n cell in Xn, but not in X prime. Okay. With the characteristic map phi I from dn Sn minus 1 plus 1, just put alpha equal to whatever Hn minus 1 we have, composite with phi. Okay. Hn minus 1 itself is defined on the whole of X. Remember that. Each H I is defined on the whole of X. So this makes sense. Okay. And now use that corollary to get a homotopy Hni on the cell En cross I to Y, such that the final result is inside Yn. Okay, and on Hn minus 1, there is no disturbance. On X prime, of course, there is no disturbance. I mean, the homotopy is identity there. So once you have for each I like this, you put all of them together, that will cover Xn. Okay, how do you take Xn cross? What is the definition? Take any point here which is not in Xn minus 1, it will be in one of the DNIs. So there you define it as Hni, that's all. So they will patch up because on the boundary, they all agree with Hn minus 1 of the boundary of this. They agree with Hn here. Therefore, we have little Hn. Now, you extend again by cofibration on the whole of X. So that's capital H. So all these properties will be following for capital H also. Okay. So the inductive step is over. Therefore, the proof is over. Okay. The following this lemma, we will make one or two definitions and then very interesting results of this one now can be deduced by applying your mind. your exercise. So I will give them as assignments or exercises to you to think about them. And they are not difficult. Now I have prepared you so much so that you can do all those things. Okay? So let me just introduce this notation, these definitions. A topological pair is said to be n-connected if for each 0 less than to k less than 10, every map from dk to sk minus 1, dk comma sk minus 1 to xa is homotopic relative to sk minus 1 to a map within A. This was the part of lemma, right? For m bigger than n and so on with the hypothesis. If this conclusion happens every time, then you call this as n-connected. So remember, so you have xa, okay? A map for every k less than or equal to n, this should happen. You don't know what is. We have proved it in some case, namely where x is got by attaching one EM cell. That's what we have proved, right? So that conclusion I am making it as a hypothesis, that's called n-connected. Okay. By convention, for D0, you have to have some convention. D0 is a singleton space. The S minus 1 is empty set. In particular, if A is a single point where X0 is a base point, okay, X0 is a base point, and you take that one, then in that case, we say X is N connected. I want to make it what is special case? A is never empty here. I will take one single point there. Then you don't mention that, you just say X is N connected. Otherwise, the pair is N connected. The condition is the same. Okay, that is N connectivity. And next, I want to define what is the meaning of these higher homotopy groups. Okay, somewhat similar to the definition of the first homotopy group, but some miraculous things happen here. The definitions are more or less same way, okay? But miraculous things happen here from dimension 1 to dimension 2, 3 and so on. 2, 3, etc. are quite different. N equal to 1 is different. Okay, so n greater than equal to 2, you define two maps f and g from in comma boundary of in. See, I have chosen the square model here again rather than the round model. Okay. So that is just a convention. That is a convenient convention. That's all. So xx naught, suppose you have two maps like this. If n equal to 1, this is just the representation of a loops or something, right? You remember that. A path is. Okay, their path is. But boundary point, both the boundary point go to x naught, they are loops. So how do you compose loops? Exactly same way I'm going to do this. Define f star g from in to x as follows. Both t1 and t2 are less than or equal to half. You take f of 2t1, 2t2, 2t and so on. So I'm just doing it for n equal to 2, but you can do it for any number, okay? 2t1, 2t2, 2tn. Okay, so all the ti's are less than equal to half. If all the ti's are between half and 1, then you take g of 2t minus 1, 2t minus. So if t is 1, then this is precisely the loop composition of f and g. Okay. But now there are all other points wherein mixed things happen. There you take the constant map x0. For all the points, t1, t2, tn will be just x0. Okay. Take this definition. Verify that, just like fundamental group, verify that it is homotopy associative. It has two-sided identity, namely the constant map, etc. Okay, so that one more thing, namely what will be the inverse of f star g? Namely, just try g equal to minus f of minus t1 in one of the coordinates, just one of the coordinates. That will be the homotopy inverse. So this will become a group. That group is going to be called as pi n, nth homotopy group of x, base point x naught. So that's the definition. Okay. So this is the inverse I have given it. F minus f t1 t2, just one of the coordinates, you just invert 1 minus t1, right? 1 minus t1 here. Okay. So this is f of minus f operating t1 t2 n is f of 1 minus t1 t2 tn. Okay. So the group so obtained is denoted by pi n of x x naught, and is nth homotopy group of x. Okay. So one more definition. N greater than equal to 1, x to y is an n equivalence. Like homotopy equivalence, it's just n equivalence, depends upon n. If it induces bijection of path components of x to y, okay, and on each component, look like take a point x, xx, okay, the ith homotopy group, pi I of xx, which we have defined just now, to pi I of y comma fx. This must be an isomorphism for all 1, 2, 3, up to n, less than n. And for I equal to n, it must be surjective. This is epimorphism. Under such thing, we call it as n equivalence. If this is n equivalence for every n, then we call it a weak homotopy equivalence. The idea is, it is very easy to see that if it is homotopy equivalence, then it is a weak homotopy equivalence. So it's very close to being homotopy equivalence. Okay. There is a big theorem called Whitehead's theorem, which says that for CW complexes, suppose X and Y are CW complexes, a weak homotopy equivalence is actually a homotopy equivalence. So what I have done so far, you know, I can give this as an exercise to you. It is not one-step exercise, a number of short exercises, all of them you can solve them. So that's what I feel, that you, if you have understood various parts of whatever I have done so far, you will be able to do that. Such a profound preparation I have done for you. Thank you.